Welcome to my review of Le Capuchadou by Fontenay-Pateau. The traditional French knives are deeply rooted in the rural life of the 18th and 19th century. At that time, knives were tools used by peasants, farmers and shepherds. They were not collectibles. The Aubrac region, a volcanic and granitic plateau in the southern Massif Central, gave birth to a famous knife, the laguiole. But the laguiole knife had a predecessor. The peasants of the Aubrac had been using knives before the invention of the laguiole knife in the 1830s. But these knives looked very different. Thanks to Christian Lemasson, I can show you what these knives looked like. The knives you are looking at are called capuchadous. The spelling and the pronunciation vary with the local dialect. The name is derived from the Occitan word for to cut or to prune. However, capuchadou was not only the name of the knife, it also became the nickname for the inhabitants of the village of Lieutadet in the southern Auvergne. The local men were called capuchadous because during the long winter evenings they carved the pegs needed to secure the stone roof tiles that are used throughout the region. You could say the capuchadou was the first laguiole. It was a fixed blade, the blade was made of thick steel, it was long and narrow and was fitted into a round handle. The handle was usually made of ash wood or boxwood and sometimes bone. And as you can see on the photo, the knife was carried in a wooden sheath. The capuchadou was used for all kinds of farm work, from sharpening sticks to killing chickens. The farmers even used the pointed tip of the blade to puncture the bloated stomachs of farm animals to relieve the pressure. Of course, the construction of this knife is completely different from the old capuchadou knife. Please note the spelling used here, it comes with a ch, so the proper pronunciation is probably capuchadou. The name is a homage to the cutlers of the 19th century. It is also a bow to the rural culture of the Aubrac region. The designer of this knife is the French knife maker Richard Zosler. His goal was to blend the past and the present by reinterpreting the old knife. After retiring from knife making in 2011, he passed on the design and the brand to Gilles Steinberg, the owner of Fontenay-Pateau. Having reviewed quite a few French knives, I'm finally very proud to introduce you to one of the finest cutlery companies of France, Fontenay-Pateau. The company exists since the 1920s and has been known for quality cutlery throughout Europe, but when Gilles Steinberg bought the company in 1994, he gave it a completely new direction. Mastermind and master craftsman Gilles Steinberg decided to return to the artisan methods of knife making. Fontenay-Pateau specialized in producing high quality laguiole knives. You could say it's their bread and butter business, the pun is intended. However, Gilles and his team at Fontenay-Pateau do not only respect the tradition and the craft, they also came up with many innovations. For example, they offer laguiole knives with a locking blade. Le Capuchadou is one of Fontenay-Pateau's latest creations. I consider it a semi-custom knife because an incredible amount of handwork goes into the making of such a knife. Plus, you can choose from various materials, not only for the handle, but also for the decoration of the shamrock. The features that connect this knife to the 19th century rural life and cutlery are very subtle. The curved handle shape was inspired by the shepherd's stick used by the shepherds and pilgrims of the Massif Central. The crook handle had a similar curvature and shape. Next, the floral symbol here, the shamrock, is a clear hint to the laguiole cutlery tradition at the end of the 19th century. Between 1880 and 1900, before the bee was used to decorate the head of the spring, the cutlers in laguiole used floral ornaments, among them the shamrock and the four-leaf clover. The handle material is buffalo bark, the outside part of the horn tip. It's a warm, natural-looking and feeling material. It comes with a high-shine finish and the natural grooves and indentations provide a unique handle. The handle scales are nicely contoured, and the whole handle slightly tapers towards the blade. The handle feels very natural in your hand. The knife is very well balanced. The handle scales are mounted on the stainless steel liners with 3 pins. The bolsters are also made of solid stainless steel. But now look at the back spring. Look at the amazing amount of detail that went into the handcrafted filework. Isn't it beautiful? Just for comparison purposes, this is a Lagiolo Nobrac knife, and the filework, le guillochage, looks rather simple compared to this. To be fair, I have to say that this knife is from the Guilloche product line, where they dedicate a substantial amount of time to work on le guillochage. Look, they even decorated the liners here and also here. The spring and the shamrock are one piece. Another highlight of the decoration is this inlay. It's a fine piece of lapis lazuli, a stone that was already used in ancient jewelry. It really adds a very special touch to the knife. By the way, Fontenay-Pateau also offers other inlays made of gems like sapphire or emerald. As far as I know, the most luxurious version of this knife features a 120-layer Damascus steel blade, a bluish mammoth ivory handle, and a genuine blue sapphire as inlay. But no matter what materials they use, these knives are pure pieces of art. I will put a link in the description to videos from Fontenay-Pateau where you can see the skilled craftsmen and craftswomen making the capuchadou. Now for the blade. First of all, it is mirror polished, which always looks splendid. The only downside is you are in fingerprint hell. The blade is made of Sandvik 12C27 stainless steel, a Swedish steel that is very common in French cutlery. And as I have mentioned many times before, it's one of my favorite steels because it is very easy to sharpen and holds an edge pretty well. The blade is flat ground and comes with a thin but very accurate secondary bevel. There is a little bit of file work on the blade as well. I wouldn't call it jimping though. Now, the blade shape is similar to a standard Lagiol knife. Technically speaking, it's a clip-point blade. It comes with a nail nick. And here we've got the Capuchadou logo, which shows the silhouette of an Aubrac peasant in his traditional blouse and with a hat. If you go to the Capuchadou website, you can see a more detailed version of the logo, where this little guy actually holds a knife in his hand. Besides the detailed filework, there is another feature that sets this knife apart from other knives. I'm talking about the incredibly smooth opening and closing of the knife. Now, this is something that is difficult to demonstrate on video, because you really need to hold this knife in your hands to feel the difference. The Capuchadou is a slip joint knife, and you might think, okay, that's a well-proven system. How can there be any innovation? Well, this slip joint knife is not that much about innovation, it's more about precision. It's about adjusting, measuring, grinding, polishing, and finishing each metallic part very carefully. Now, first of all, the blade locks into place with authority. Although technically speaking, it's not a lock, but the spring is very strong. There are 3 phases when closing a slip joint knife. First, by pressing on the spine of the blade, you put the blade in the half stop position, like so. In the second phase, you can rotate the blade within a range of roughly 50 to 60 degrees in this direction. After this point, the blade accelerates and it feels like as if the blade gets sucked into the handle. Now, that's pretty much how all slip joints with a 90-degree stop work. But here, every phase, especially the last two phases, is so smooth, so well balanced, you can close this knife so gently. The only comparison I can come up with is the difference between closing the door of a BMW and a cheap car. But even if you let the blade snap shut, you don't have to worry, because unlike many Lagyol knives, the Capuchadou comes with a blade stop, so the blade doesn't hit the back spring. I usually start my reviews with the specifications of a knife, but this time I wanted to share with you the history and the beauty of this knife first. But of course, the cold facts are important, so here are the numbers. The closed length is 12 cm. By the way, Fontenay-Pateau also offers a 10 cm version of Le Capuchadou. The total length is 21 cm. The blade length is 9.5 cm. The blade thickness is 3 mm. And the weight comes in at 126 grams. Finally, let's take a look at this elegant leather sheath. It's also made in France. I like the contrast between the black leather and the white stitching. Very beautiful. On the inside, this rivet is covered with some soft material, so the handle doesn't get scratched. The sheath comes with a dual belt loop for either horizontal or vertical carry. And of course, the knife fits in here perfectly. Le Capuchadou is definitely the current highlight of my entire knife collection. It's hard to find another knife with such bewitching beauty, rich history, and on top of all, this high level of craftsmanship. It's one of the knives where you can debate whether or not you should use it, or if you should hang it on the wall. I decided to use it because it's such a pleasure to use this knife. It's a piece of art, but it's very functional at the same time. In 2008, Fontenay-Pateau achieved the label Entreprise du Patrimoine Vivant, in English, Living Heritage Company. And I have to say, they live up to this label.